This project was supported by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency, through its regional arts funding partnership, Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts, PPA. State government funding for the arts depends upon an annual appropriation by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and support from the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. PPA is administered in this region by Berks Arts Council.
Arts programming on BCTV is also supported by the Wachovia Foundation.
New Arts Alive features a guest artist who will share their work for a better understanding of today's art. Program moderator is James Carroll. During the live presentation, the home viewer has the opportunity to call and speak directly with the artist. New Arts Alive is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit arts service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. New Arts Alive is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, area businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions.
Good evening. I'd like to welcome you to New Arts Alive. And with me is my guest, Patricia Hall. And but I guess you go by Pat.
I go by Pat.
And we're going to, well, she is going to give us a lot of information dealing with block printing and some ideas with it, and I'm going to kind of agitate her a little with it.
Okay.
And what she's going to do starting off is give you sort of an idea of the parameter and a synopsis of what we would like to talk about tonight.
Okay.
Okay, Pat.
Okay, thank you. You know, you can agitate me. You can ask me all the questions that I don't know the answers to. Okay.
Yeah, but those are fun then.
Those are the best kind, and you always know the answers, so therefore it works, right? I want to talk about block printing, and I wanted to talk a little bit. It's relief printing. Some people may have heard of it, many have not. It's a worldwide art form. I'm looking at it as a European or German art form. And basically, we'll go through a little bit of the history of it, where it came from, the types of things it was used for, some of the artists whose names you may know, who have used print-type work, engraving or block printing, and all of its uses and how it translates into the modern world, and some of the work that that I've been doing with it and other folks have been doing with it. And then I'd like to go through and just explain the process, because everyone thinks that this would be so difficult, and it's actually very simple. It's a very simple process. It can be messy. It can be very messy because you're dealing with ink. I use a water-soluble ink, but it's still ink, so you have ink everywhere, you know, all over your face, your clothes, just expect it. But I've tried to be very neat in a lot of the work that I do, and I've just given up, and I have clothes that I wear just for that, and they're my ink clothes or my paint clothes or whatever.
You know, when you were in grade school and you had the paste, that white paste?
Remember that? It smelled so good, and you wanted to eat it.
We ate a lot of it.
You wanted to eat it. You had to eat the paste.
Paint.
Don't eat the ink or the paint.
But you know, it's too bad that they don't. That way, an artist would never go hungry.
That's right. We're all poor, starving artists,
yeah.
Right? So I got into it actually at a very young age. My grandfather was Austrian. Right over from Austria, and he was a carpenter, but he did a lot of wood carving. He did a lot
was
of.
Was he Fritz?
He was a Reichert.
Reichert.
Fritz is the other side of the family.
Oh, the other side.
He was Reichert, so he did a lot of wood carving, decorative work on the furniture that he made, and the cribs and the furniture that he made for people, and what he got into. Then he would do little blocks for me, and I always had a stamp set when I was a child. He did it, carved
it.
He carved some out of rubber, hard rubber stamp sets, and he carved some little blocks for me. But my mother would buy me those little stamp ink pad things.
Yes.
Because she didn't want me, you know, dealing with ink everywhere. So I would do everything on a little ink pad and, you know, build and make little designs from, you know, the alphabet based on, you know, whatever I was thinking at the time. So then I got away from it for years, and then I got kind of interested in the history of it. And I'm not an art historian by any means, but I came up, this book is like from 1963, so this is like a while ago. I just, if anyone is interested in woodcut history, this is a two-volume book by a guy named Arthur Hind. I'm sure there are a lot of them out there. It has 484 illustrations.
Which you like.
Between the two books. Which I like. It's not, it's fairly easy to read, but it's not one of those pick it up and read it page to page. But it's
a reference.
It's a great reference book because it takes you through, it gives you all the little, I don't know if you can see the pictures, but there's woodblock. This is a wood block. There are engravings, which of course are much finer. There's Albrecht Dürer's in here, whom I love. There's, I don't know if you can see that, but anyway, there's all kinds of pages. This is a combination. I'll bring it up, I'll bring it down, there you go. At one point, they actually woodblocked entire books, the whole page, the print, and all the pictures in the frontispieces, which is very clever. But this is a good set. Arthur Hind, you can tell I've had it for a while.
And it's a two-volume,
H-I-N-D, Hind, or Hind, but I say Hind, so I'm not sure. But what he talks about...
I think it's that price anymore?
What was that?
$3.50?
Let me take my glasses down here for a second, please. My little
$3.50.
Yeah, $3.50. You know how long ago?
I don't believe it.
You know
maybe on
you know how long
maybe
ago,
on Amazon, you know? or on.
And that's for two of them. That's for the two-volume set, $3.50.
Boy, that's a while
that's
back.
That's a classic. This is a while back, but you know, you keep these things. You know, it's been a good set. But in here and in other places, this is just such an old art form. You know, from the time people were playing in the mud and got something on their hand and put it on a rock. They have all these cave paintings and the artist, you know, handprint. At some point somebody must have said, oh, if I can do that, what else can I do? You know, what else can I print everywhere? And so just all over the place. And some of the initial things that were done are from the Far East, actually. It's as far back. The earliest ones they can find are from the Far East, China. And they were actually used not to print on paper initially, but on cloth. So they did beautiful block prints, relief prints on their silks and on their cloths to decorate.
Chinese were the ones that invented paper, wasn't it?
Rice paper, which is one of the things
yes.
that we use here. I have
before that.
That
you use skin.
Yeah, use skin, hide.
Yeah.
Hide, skin, but then you discover that you can stamp things on just about any surface you can find and you begin to decorate. And that's what people did. Now, Europe, when it hit Europe, and people were doing this, but they started doing it in books. You know, they were building libraries and
well, that would be the 1400s.
1400s, 1400s, probably late 1400s.
Yeah.
I think when the books started, and
printing
prior
press.
To the printing press came in, which was part of this. But they had some very early ones, a little bit earlier that were just pieces, You know, they were not in books. They didn't come along with printing, but they were part of the actual piece. And they used it for playing cards. The French or the Italians, I can't remember which ones, decided to do woodblock playing cards. So they were doing books. They were doing playing cards. They were doing stationery. They were doing cloth as well. And it became very decorative, all the woodblock printing. And it's different. You know, I looked through this, and when I was first looking through it years ago, I was beginning to think, okay, which is an engraving and which is a woodblock? And I had to think what, like, the difference is, because the woodblocks tend to be grosser. I mean, as in not as refined.
The cuts
as
the are more distinguishable.
The cuts are more distinguishable, and you can see some of the carvings in it because of the tools you're using. And there are some large ones there.
These are all wood, but these are closer to some of the metal pieces that would be etching, using a fine point and pushing it into the metal.
Right, you push it into the metal, and then the printing itself.
You get a burr on it, which
and it
curls.
Right.
And then it holds the ink.
Right. And then you need a lot of pressure to press down on that in order to squeeze that ink back out of that
metal.
Well,
you clean out the raised,
right?
The raised area. You clean off the ink, whereas with the block printing, you're
just covering it. You're just taking
the roller
and covering the whole thing.
And usually, it's raised considerably more, higher.
Yes.
With the wood.
Yes. Yes.
And
so it's really interesting, but that very fine engraving where the ink is squished into it, and then it you have to, like you said, they clean it, but then that the pressure that it takes to press it back out, you know, back
that
onto,
was before onto, they had ball bearings.
That was before they had ball bearings.
So you really had to jump up on that wheel to really turn it.
Exactly. So relief printing is exactly what you're saying. It's where you take these implements that are not as fine as engraving, and you actually gouge out your wood, and then you cover it with ink. So this is what we started to work on, and we do the hex signs. So we're always doing variations of those, and we said, well, what's Hunter Yoder, who is my partner, he has done block printing, mostly portraits of people. He does portraits of folks, and we know a few other artists who also started doing them, and I know we have someone else to show here that is also doing them. So as you go on, and you get people like who are exquisite, like Albert Durer, who, you know, there should be a whole show just on Durer and his work. I know there are books on him, but his engraving is absolutely exquisite.
You're using the wood in a different way when you engrave.
Totally different. Yeah, totally different.
You use the end instead of the side of it.
Yes.
And so it's much more detail. It's almost like metal.
It's almost like metal. It's almost like pen and ink drawing. You know, it's so fine, and it's so close. Whereas carving, and I have one that's partially carved here. This is a piece that is, I don't know if you can. I'm holding that this way.
Maybe show it over here.
Yeah,
this piece that you're carving here is this hex sign here.
Is that hex sign?
But it's the center part, without
center
the border
part of the hex sign.
Of the hex
so
sign.
You can see the rooster here. If you can get a picture of that in a second, we'll take a look at where this.
But you
came
can see
from.
where. Really,
and
you haven't gone too deep.
Fade in. That was nicely done. That's actually that rooster is a detail of a much larger, maybe 4 or 5 times that size hex sign that we did, and then we just took the rooster and made it and as a smaller piece, but then also took it and drew it onto, this is just a piece of plywood, a piece of white pine from Home Depot.
Not plywood, it's a regular piece of.
Well, it's a piece of wood, not plywood, but yeah. White pine from Home Depot. And then we start the carving, and we start picking up the tool and starting to just, and I'm not going to actually do it.
Well,
the
different kinds of tools which give you different kinds of marks.
There are all different kinds. Yeah. You can buy a set of these at Utrecht is where we got these from. So there are chisel types, and there are gouging types, you know, that carve out, and different widths. So you can actually see, when we print some of this, you're actually going to see the lines where this is a very small one where we carved in. And what you do is you get your composition, whatever it is, you know, whatever it is, draw it, and then be sure you know what you want to, where your negative space is, what you're carving out, and what you're leaving there to actually print. So you can see we've carved out.
So all the raised areas are the printing.
All the raised areas are what will print. It's called relief printing, and the raised areas are the things that print. Now,
like down here in the area where you have not made a smooth surface, but you've gouged it out.
Right.
Some of those raised areas will pick up some ink.
They will pick up ink, and they will look like fine lines.
But they will be sort of have a crude quality to them.
Exactly.
Isn't that
more of a
one way?
A grosser. I never know what to call it. I call it grosser as opposed to refined. But it's a cruder. It's more of a folk artsy kind of a thing. Plus, on some areas, you want to show texture within the wing or something. So you want these little raised areas. And it will pick up ink. As you said, it will pick up the ink.
And well, that's a good part.
That's what you want it to do.
Yes.
Yes, that's what you want it to do.
That's part of what wood cutting or wood block printing is about.
Right. So you can take this. Now, we have friends who do linocut, which is same kind of relief cutting on linoleum. And I have never tried that. But he gets linoleum. He mounts it on a wood block and then basically uses similar tools and does the same kind of carving. And I find that from watching him, it looks easier than carving the wood.
Well, you don't have knots in it.
You don't have the knots.
Irregular qualities.
You don't have the irregular qualities. Sometimes with wood, depending on where the plank came from, it's the older parts, the ins are harder to carve than some of the outer areas.
See, this area, the dark areas here, would be a little harder.
Yeah, because they're like knots. They're the little knots.
Yeah.
And that's the beauty, one of the beauties of wood.
But linoleum, there is no knots.
No, and it's much easier. It seems so. I haven't tried it yet, but it seems much easier. But you can get into some fine areas, but it is a more rugged kind of effect to it.
See, this is, again, the same size as this middle section without the border, the
right
section around it, so that
right, it's just the rooster part of that particular piece. So then I found these. They're very small. I don't know if they're going to actually even show up.
The camera can come.
There you go. I found these in England some years ago, and it's carved wood. You can see there's a kind of a design inside. There it is. It's a thistle, little thistle with little petals. Yeah, could you take that, please? Thank you. And if I were to print this just as is in ink and print it, I would just get this outer ridge. But this is made for cookies. Or biscuits, which is cookies in the UK, And so what you do is you press down on the soft dough and it leaves the imprint. And the smaller double thistle right here is actually a butter press, just a little butter press.
Or clay.
It's the same thing. Or clay.
Clay.
Yeah, yeah, you know.
Or putty.
Or putty or paper mache, because you could also use these kind of reverse, it's kind of like carved in. You could also use these, press it down in your clay, get the design, let it harden, paint it. I had never thought of that. These have just been sitting on my kitchen counter as for cookies and butter, but I may try that now. And in fact, I may try making a couple of these things with the design inside, so I can press it down into clay.
Now, you were saying that you and Hunter are just opening.
Yes.
A gallery.
Yes, we opened a gallery. It's called the Hex Factory, since we primarily do
Pennsylvania Dutch.
Pennsylvania, I mean, that's German. Yeah, Pennsylvania Dutch, German art and hex signs. And
that's a kind of a misnomer name, Dutch.
It's from the Deutsch.
Yeah,
it's from Deutsch for
Deutsch.
German. Yeah, I know, but it's Dutch. And we will do variations of hex signs, and we'll do woodblock, and we have other friends who have also joined us that sometimes show. And we do have a show. We have a show coming up starting in early first Friday in September. It will open. Don't know the date. The first Friday in September, but it's all relief printing. So it's going to be a combination of woodcut and lino cut. So that's linoleum and wood by about four different artists, including myself and Hunter and several others. So that's what we'll be doing. So, and we're also going to have a 2-month gallery show at Clay on Main and Ole with all the hex signs. So that's in September as well. So we're just
so
showed out.
Yoder and
Yoder and Hall. No. Yoder and Hall. So, let me just show you.
Okay, some images.
Some images here. This is from a friend of ours who is named David Aponte.
Okay, we have a home viewer. Do you have a question?
Yes, I do.
Hello.
I'd like to know where I can find you guys.
We are, the gallery is called the Hex Factory. It's in Fishtown in Philadelphia. But we'll also be doing a full show at Clay on Main in Ole, beginning Thursday, September the 8th, and it will go for 2 months. And it will be all of the hex signs. And at that point in time, all the woodcuts will be down at the gallery in Philadelphia.
Okay, and I wanted them to know that I've been satisfied. I'm new in the area. And I was always wondering why on earth the German immigrants would call themselves Dutch, because that means you're from Holland. And
true.
They just clarified that for me. It was a open mistake.
It's true. It's from the Deutsch.
So I appreciate that.
That's
Thank
from
you.
The Deutsch. You're very welcome. Thank you. So this fellow, these are two very nice little pieces.
You can show this one.
This is his second one. And he's just trying his hand at this. Actually, he has a master's in printmaking. But he's just beginning to do details from hex signs, from Pennsylvania Deutsch or Pennsylvania German work. Went down to the Philadelphia Museum of Art and saw the full collection. Of course, the Pennsylvania Germans decorated everything. So there's no dearth of ideas for taking a piece here and there and doing a woodcut. So
most of their patterns are very simple, like tulips.
Very simple tulips
and
hearts.
And making them, dealing with the flatness of the image.
Right.
In other words, there's right. very little dimensional qualities.
Not three dimensional. Not with work. Even in color, no, there's not. There's not shadings and colorings. It's very much a folk art, and it's some beautiful stuff. And that's the Pennsylvania German piece. I'll just show you one more piece that he did. And it might be a little tricky. It might be hard to see because he cut away. There it is. The relief is really the background, which is then he cut away the faces. And this is Alice in Wonderland, which everyone knows is Pennsylvania German.
With a rabbit in there.
With the Mad Hatter. And the rabbit, the white rabbit, and actually the fellow in the middle is the artist himself wearing lederhosen. So this kind of makes it German.
This is one of 25, or
one of 25. When people make woodcut and prints like this, they usually are numbering,
numbering. But they don't necessarily make a large edition, or which it could be a second edition of the same thing.
I don't know. To tell you the truth, I don't know.
What does this mean? Like two and one?
Oh, you're right. I didn't see the two. There probably is a second cut at this, yeah. Yep, one of 25, second edition.
Something in that order, yeah.
Something like that, yeah. We didn't quite do that. Here's the last one that I did. We can talk through this, and we can talk through a process. This is actually on rice paper, and this is that. That love and marriage hex sign. Zobrei Garten is the name of our website, and it's written in Fractur here. But it's, you can see on this one, you can see all of this.
All the marks. You can tell it's wood.
All the marks, and that is a clear indication that this is definitely a woodcut and nothing else, because
have qualities like that with linoleum, but the only thing is, if you leave enough depth to it where it won't pick up, but then you lose that particular quality.
Yes.
Then.
Yeah.
And then it becomes just totally black and white, where here you have all the kind of variations that go on with
Exactly.
And what's interesting on what we see now is a hex sign painting.
A hex sign painting with all the colors that are normally there, and then it translates over to black and white.
Here you have it on paper.
And here it's on paper, and it's translated to just black and white with all the all the carving work that went into it to get it over here. So it's
now, if you were to make that in color, then you would make each one of the hearts maybe would be different colors, or all of the hearts would be a color, and then the leaves would be another color, or
probably do no more than three colors if on a wood block. I mean, I haven't gotten into color yet. I mean, I just say, okay, now how do we do that? Okay, this is so you have to cut and print, and then you have to recut and put different ink on, and do it again, and so I'm not really sure. I actually like the starkness of the black and white on a lot of these, because the hex signs and the work tends to be pretty colorful, and then you take it over to like this flat black and white, and it's like, I like black and white TV though too, so what can I say? I haven't grown up. I like the black and white TVs, but there it is. So it's a very interesting and easy process, actually, and probably going to be doing some workshops on it. we'll talk about that when we come back.
We have station identification for about 60 seconds. We're going back to radio now.
You're watching New Arts Alive on bctv.org. Be informed. Be involved. Be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and an arts calendar, go to www.bctv.org. New Arts Alive is underwritten by the Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts and the Wachovia Foundation. For more information on how you and your business can become program underwriters, go to www.bctv.org.
Welcome back. With me is my guest, Patricia Hall. Pat, and okay, Pat, you can
I thought we could talk a little bit about the process itself, because it's something that really isn't that difficult. I know I was on some shows ago, and we talked about the process of making hex signs, you know, and what we went through. But this is even simpler. This is even simpler. So I'm just going to go through the process fairly quickly. I'm looking for the woodcut one, the cut version. Yeah, we'll just take that. Here are the things that you need. You know, you need a piece of wood. This, as I said, is the less knots on it, the better. This one has a few, so we're using the less knotty side, or the less damaged side. But you can get this from Home Depot. This is white pine from Home Depot, which is not that hard of a wood. The preparation is probably what takes the most. We use a large marble slab on which to spread the ink. So you can do it on a large marble, glass,
metal,
anything that isn't porous, because you don't want it.
Plexiglass,
plastic sheets,
but not something that's like a mylar.
Yeah,
or a sheet. It's loose, you know, like a curtain. You can't.
It has to be rigid. It has to be rigid, and it shouldn't be porous, because you don't want it sucking up your ink. You know, you want it to hold the ink. And once you have that, pretend that this is just a piece of whatever. They do sell block printing ink. There's all different kinds. This is Speedball.
Yes, the brand, and it's brand. Water. This is water soluble,
this
so you don't have to worry about toxic qualities with this, or you do with oil or lacquer base.
Right.
I mean, there's only three kinds that you can have. You can have shellac base, which is alcohol. You can have oil,
mm-hmm.
or you can have lacquer,
mm-hmm.
and
Water, which is the best for me because of cleanup. It's easy to work with, and it's not ink that's going to pour out. It's actually very, very thick. So you get your ink, you get your board, you get a kitchen spoon, you take some whole glob of ink out, here's my soup spoon and my woodblock printing spoon. Just use it. Use whatever you have. Take it out. Glob on there. Take a glob. Then this is a ink roller. Also, you can get any craft shop, you know. And you basically have your ink, your glob of ink, because it's thick. And then you start rolling it. What you want to do is you want to get it to a very even and thin consistency, with no bubbles and no burbles and no things in it.
So actually you take your roller and you, on your table with the ink, and you roll it out so that you cover the roller first.
Yes.
And you get an even coating on the...
And you roll it out.
And then you can go over on your piece of wood that you've cut.
Then, then you have it, because what you've done is you've got it nice and you know, all the bubbles and everything are gone and your roller's covered.
Not too heavy, because if it is, nice, then it kind of makes meringue.
You like
make mountains or peaks.
When you're trying, what you try to do with egg whites, but you don't want that here. You don't want the peaks to come up. So, and then you roll it. You roll it over your cut wood.
And it comes off on the raised areas.
And it comes out on the raised areas and does not sink into, because it's thin. It's not like you're layering on, lathering on like cake icing. You know, this is very thin, and you roll it evenly, and you keep going, rolling evenly, until you get it covered very nicely. Then they have things called printing paper. This is actually, I'm gonna use this one. This is rice paper. Now, when we were doing it, I always thought you had to soak the paper.
That depends on the weight of the paper.
Yeah, someone told me I didn't have to even for this, but I soaked the paper. I soaked the paper, had a big tub of water, soaked the paper, took it out, dripped it off, laid it down, took a rolling pin, my big rolling pin for making pies, and kind of squished the water out, and that's what I used.
You can also use, that they use in printmaking, which is a blotter type of, that you take the wet paper and put it between two of them, and that way you can take out the excessive moisture so that it's still damp.
But
you can also use it dry, and then
it would be much easier to do it dry. Next time I'm definitely doing it dry, because I was rolling out the water.
Do you use the spoon?
I use the spoon.
This is the special spoon.
Use the back of the spoon. Back of the spoon, because what you do is you lay your paper on your cut that is now covered with ink, and you take your spoon and you just start rubbing evenly all over, just keep going, and then you very carefully peel it up.
Kind of peel it.
Peel it slowly. Peel it up. I'll do that again. And then you slowly peel it up.
Kind of roll it off.
And then you slowly roll it off, and you pick it up, and you get something like this. And that, then you just, everything washes because it's that. So then you check to see what you have. If you have enough to do a second one, fine. I've done that. Usually there's not enough ink on it. You go back to your roller and your ink, you gather your ink on your roller again, you go over your woodcut, you prepare your next piece of paper, and you continue on. And every print is then basically handmade. And then we think about people doing this for whole books and great detail and actually printing, and it's an amazing process.
Well, the monks did that.
In their scriptoriums. I mean, they did this, and they did all the handwriting, and
not only in Europe, but they also did, the monks did it in Tibet. You know, things were hand done back basically before 1400.
Right.
Because you didn't have a printing press. We accept it as being normal, but...
Yeah, we think it was all so easy, but it's...
We think of computers as being normal in a lot of cases. I remember my kids, they didn't even know what a typewriter was when they saw one.
That's true, and people say to me...
That's not that long ago.
I know, and they say, you go through all that, and I'm saying... All of what? You know, it's a piece of wood, it's my spoon, it was my rolling pin, it's some ink, and it's something that I'm making with my own hands.
Well, you could actually use the rolling pin.
Could use a rolling pin as
well. If you had a big piece of wood.
Exactly. Yeah, you could. I've never.
To physically put together a number of pieces of wood or pieces that you've cut.
Right, and then fit them together and do each one. Yeah, yeah.
And then the bigger roller would advantage.
It might be an advantage because you want to keep this going. You want it even. You want it to basically all start, you know, being wet and drying at the same time, and then you just go one right after another. But a lot of people have said, well, why aren't you, you know, working digitally or, you know, and I just can't even get into that. I would rather do everything by hand. And there's something to be said for a craft like this. When you're working like this, you are working the way your ancestors did, basically. You know, this is not something that should really be lost.
You're doing it by choice, though.
And I'm doing it by choice.
Because that's the only way that it can be done.
Well, when they were doing it, that's true. It was the only way it could be done. But then they refined it. And it was exquisite. But that's how simple the process is. So people like to create. People like to do things, you know? I mean, that's why I like to do all the hex signs. That's why once you do a hex sign, you do a hex sign. But there are so many variations because art is composition. And there are so many things that can be put into this. And we could do this same rooster again 100 different ways with 100 different other things along with it. Right now it has
Well, you can recarve
bunny
it.
Rabbits. We can recarve it.
Different
because I know, every time you get an idea in your head and you start, as soon as you start putting it down on paper or on anything, it changes. And then the next thing you do to it, it changes. And the next thing you do to it, and then it becomes a life
you
of its own.
You can keep adding to it.
So everything we have, we can basically do a woodblock on. And some mine are neater than others because this is
just regular wood can be of a large size. Now, when you're talking about etching, wood etching, you're talking usually about a small pieces because it's more delicate, exceedingly delicate, because of the way you're cutting. At the end of the wood instead of with the grain.
And
sometimes you can, the grains can be very strong, and consequently you're cutting, you can go across the grain as well as go with the grain.
So you can,
because you see, if you look close at wood here, you can see where the grain changes. The dark areas or lines that you see here, that's harder. I don't know if that can.
It's the actual lines in the wood.
I don't know if we can. But there are. Can we happen to get one of the cameras on the side here?
Yeah, that's. Oh, you can actually see them now. I can see them.
Okay. Those are harder, and in between each one of those lines, it's soft.
Right.
Or softer.
Softer. Yeah.
Softer. Yeah. And you can gouge it out much easier, and so it's almost like going like that. And,
So you can see a lot of this is mostly following those lines.
Yes.
Yeah, because it was.
Now
it
down
was
here
easier.
You can see where it's wider. There's a wide area.
Right. Right.
And
right.
Almost like the knot element that's involved with it.
Yeah, and those are the tree's growth lines. So you get this, you know, this dark growth line working its way through, and. It's really It's interesting. It's the kind of work that you just get given. They did everything. They did maps with woodblock. I mean, some of the things that were done were amazing. But that's what we're doing. And other people are doing it as well. Do you want to show Pam's, or can I show some others? Or
yeah. Let's go to Pam's. The black and white one, the figure, the small one in the black frame. You can see here, it's the same image, repeated,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But you can see where the black lines and where the white lines.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're dealing with a structure.
Mm-hmm.
It actually comes through very simple.
Yeah, it looks very simple, but really, I mean, you can see she had to
carve one way.
It takes
much more thought and concentration.
Yeah, a lot more thought because of the relief.
And it's linoleum. This is linoleum,
not wood.
Oh, this
is linocut. Okay.
It's so you don't have to deal with knots.
Right, right.
And
it's softer.
You can be more consistent.
Yeah, it's softer.
With, the edges and the
yeah, because you look at some of the lines on woodcuts, you can tell some of the lines where they're not quite as neat and precise because they just it just doesn't work that way all the time. Depends on how good a carver you are, I guess. I'm not quite that good yet. So
mine
are a little rough.
I borrowed this work from an exhibition that's at the New Arts Program right now, which is a small work show of 167 works.
Wow.
This happens to be one of them. And because it fits in with this block printing.
Yeah, and yeah, it's definitely block printing.
And I thought it would be a good opportunity to...
Yeah.
Now, this exhibition is over this Saturday.
Where is that located?
It's at 173 West Main Street in Kutztown, PA. And so basically by appointment or Friday, Saturday, it's from 11 to 3. Those are the specific times. If you have other times during those days, I'm usually there pretty much all the time.
I know. So. And I'll just say this again, for the lady who called in, thank you very much. The Hex Factory is at 2080 East Cumberland Street in Philadelphia, and it's by appointment only except for either some kind of major exhibition or every first Friday of the month. There's a new show that starts with artists, but it can be...
When are the hours on that?
The hours for first Fridays are from 6 to 10 on those evenings. And then it's by appointment and by appointment only. I could give you the number to call. I don't know if I'm going to remember the number. This is where I have to have a big thing big sign to hold up. But it's actually on Facebook. If anyone's on Facebook and you go to the Hex Factory, you'll see announcements for what's going on there, and you'll see all the contact information. But we are now just really beginning to move into more woodblock.
Oh, you're just starting.
We've done
this gallery.
Yeah, this gallery's new. This gallery just opened. One room of it opened first Friday in June, and there's a second large room that's under construction right now. And once that opens, it'll be fairly full. It'll be full. So it's kind of exciting. I'm just getting ready. But that's what we're doing. So now we're moving more into, now that we have all these hex signs and we have all these details all the composite details from all the different Pennsylvania German artists we could find in there, we're now pulling elements out like this rooster and saying, this would be a very nice woodcut. So we're beginning to do more woodcuts. And Hunter, I think I mentioned this, but he's done portrait woodcuts of portraits, which is very, very cool. When he was much younger, back in the 70s, he was doing this. You know, he's an old man.
He's an old man. Do you have any other pieces?
I think we've seen almost everything. Here's one. This is an interesting piece. This is by Jacob Aponte. Jacob Bruner is his Pennsylvania Deutsch name. It's a conglomeration of his mother's side of the family, but his real name's David Aponte. And this is, I think, Dance of the Dead or Day of the Dead. But he actually has, as I said, a master's in printmaking. He teaches it. He teaches it out at the Mennonite College in Lancaster, Mennonite University in Lancaster. And so he does some interesting things.
But you can see the grain.
And you can see the grain.
See the grain on
very
the
much,
background of this.
Very much. You
all
can
those
see
lines
the grain.
Are the grain. In other
all
words,
the
a
lines.
Hard
yeah.
edge of the grain.
It's hard to see on TV, but what looks like a sheen or something is actually individual carved lines. That's the grain. So he does. He also did the Mad Hatter with himself. And then there's one small one.
Small. Almost a linear quality.
Two. Actually, these are in the show hanging right now. So he's got several of these. This is his Scarlet Woman series in red ink, and that's very hard to see, which might be good because she has no clothes on. So, there you go. But you can see it's just very fine cut. Very fine cuts. And I don't know what
yeah,
he,
this
what
is
he
one
used.
Of 50. What is your?
This is one of 50.
Oh, they're a set.
Yeah, they're a set. He has actually more to this set, but these are two of his.
Yeah, I think one thing that's quite interesting is that Pat is working with the hex signs as paintings,
mm-hmm.
and then actually taking from those and using in another medium.
Yes.
And in this case, the subject, block printing.
Yes.
And Pat is going to be coming back a couple more times to do some other subjects within this Dutch, or I shouldn't say Dutch, German background. Influence.
Danke, yes.
Yeah.
This is actually, and here, let me do that. This is actually Fruchter. And I think that's our next topic to talk about Fruchter.
Yes.
This is done on wood. Fruchter traditionally is done on paper. I just did this one on wood. This is a little Halsaken, Alles ist heilig. It just is always
traditionally
always
done
blessed.
On paper, but it
it's
doesn't have to be.
Traditionally done on paper doesn't have to be.
It could be block printed, couldn't it?
I block printed it. This is block printed right here. I think I've lost it. Nope, there it is. Zobrigarten, the printing at the bottom of this is Fruchter. And it's a font that was developed, maybe about 500 years ago in Germany. But what they used it for mostly, there's a long history to it, but it was baptismal certificates, marriage certificates, house sagans, house blessings, all kinds of things.
So they were all hand done.
They were all hand done, and they're absolutely exquisite. I do them on wood at kind of a grosser level, but they were all hand done. Mostly not with color, but then some people started applying color, very like wash of color, and it's a beautiful font, and it's interesting to try to write it. You know? Fruchter just means fractured in German. It's broken. It's got all the not
parts.
Not a clean font. Yeah. It's got all these hooks and things in it. So, but we'll do a lot on Fruchter.
Okay.
Next time.
Okay. Thank you, Pat.
Thank
for
you
being with us this evening. I'd like to thank the audience for tuning in. I'm James Carroll, and good night.
New Arts Alive is produced through Berks Community Television and can be seen live on the second Tuesday of each month at 5 p.m. Consult your local community cable service for live and repeat programming. For more information about the New Arts program and its consultation residencies of artists from the literary, visual, and performing arts, call 683-6440 or write New Arts Program, P.O. Box 82, Kutztown, PA 19530. Or visit the office and exhibition space at 173 West Main Street, Kutztown, PA.
Hours are Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, 1 to 5, Saturday, 10 to 2, or by appointment.
This project was supported by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency, through its regional arts funding partnership, Pennsylvania Partners in the Arts, PPA. State government funding for the arts depends upon an annual appropriation by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and support from the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency. PPA is administered in this region by Berks Arts Council.
Arts programming on BCTV is also supported by the Wachovia Foundation.